From Buck Island Studios in lovely West Yarmouth, Massachusetts, this is the Liberty Freelance Podcast. I am your host, Phil Lindeman, libertyfreelance.com. Folks, go to libertyfreelance.com if you would so kindly, and to the left of the join button, you're going to find there, let me adjust my mic for a second, you're going to find there a donate button. If you enjoy the content, you've been getting something out of the content that you're receiving from these podcasts, please do me a favor, go to the donate button, and anything that you donate, be it $500, $50, or $5, goes not into the pocket of Dr. Lindeman, but rather goes to purchase advertising so that we can spread the message of the freelance lifestyle and the liberty that it affords you, and I'd appreciate so much if you do. We've only got a couple things in the stack today. I'd like to keep the program short if I'm able to do that. I tend to be long-winded for the best of all possible reasons, which is that I have a lot of freelance work to do. I have had no shortage of freelance work during the COVID crisis, I'm happy to say. And that is not in small part to my own efforts to pound the pavement and to find this work. Nothing falls into your lap, folks. I want to tell you about the way the narrative surrounding freelance work and the COVID crisis has been shaping up and why I believe it's wrong. I want to tell you what I've been consuming in other media, which I find just interesting. I don't expect anybody else to, but I certainly enjoy talking about it. Maybe a brief word about what's going on in a side gig that I've got going, and I do want to tell you all about that. But first, I have to ask you a question. What do you do with an elephant with three balls? I want you to think about this, so I'm going to ask the question again, give you time to think. What do you do with an elephant with three balls? And the answer is, walk him and pitch to the rhino. And now we get to the part of this show called No Joke is Made Funnier by Having to Explain It, but explain it I will. This is a combination of two jokes. It is an elephant joke, of which there are many, most of them enjoyed by individuals 12 years of age plus or minus 3 years, and adults who enjoy that type of humor. And it is also a baseball joke, and I acknowledge that an enormous proportion of my listeners do not understand how baseball is played. So this is a joke that sounds like it's a bit off color, and perhaps depending on your point of view, it is off color. But really, if you're playing a team of animals and you're a pitcher, and you've got four balls and the batter walks, three strikes and he's out. If you've got a power hitter up there and you've got three balls, the hitter knows that you need to throw a strike. And if you don't throw a strike, the animal is going to walk or the batter is going to walk and thereby occupy first base. However, if you do throw a strike and he knows a fastball down the middle is coming, which is a sure strike, he's going to be waiting for it and he is likely to hit an extra base hit, perhaps even a home run. So what you should do if you've got three balls on most hitters or a rhino, an elephant in this case, an elephant, big strong animal, you know, likely to hit the ball out of the park if you groove one down the middle, is just walk him intentionally and pitch to the next batter in the lineup, which in this case is a rhinoceros. So, once again, it took about four times or eight times longer to explain the joke. And, of course, this has nothing to do with the theme of today's show. It's just that Dr. Lindeman is scraping the bottom of the barrel of jokes that are appropriate to tell in any context. There we have it. So I want to tell you a little bit about what I've been consuming in the media world. I've been spending a fair amount of time on YouTube watching lectures given by university professors. Now, not always in the context of university lectures for credit, although one can do this. In fact, one can obtain online for free virtually the equivalent of a bachelor's level undergraduate education without one, ever leaving the home, or two, paying a dollar of tuition. That is, one, stay at home, you don't have to pay room and board. Two, you also don't have to pay tuition. Now, the fact that nobody actually does this is everything that you need to know about the state of education today. And that is that it's all about the piece of paper. It's got nothing to do with the stuff that you learned, the level of your education. All of these professors have their stuff, their best stuff, online. And I've been blessed to be able to take part of it. What I've been consuming in the last week in particularly are lectures about the evolution of birds. As you may have known, that I may have told you in previous episodes, that here in lovely Cape Cod, I've been taking advantage of the really fantastic wildlife that is here year-round. I mean, we're getting into late fall here, and there still is terrific birdage. I took part in a survey Cape-wide throughout the entirety of Cape Cod, which is a spit of sand that sticks out into the Atlantic Ocean off of the coast of Massachusetts. Throughout the whole Cape, I and a group of other people divided up all of the ponds on Cape Cod, and we counted the waterfowl, ducks, swans, geese, etc., on Saturday and Sunday, and it was, I have to say, it was not unpleasant, considering the fact that it rained, and it rained hard on Saturday and on Sunday. It was very cold, but at least it was bright and sunny. And we counted the birds and entered them on a website, and tracking the bird population of waterfowl over time. I understand that people are doing backyard bird counts in December and January as well. And so I'm interested in the evolution of birds, excuse me, as I'm interested in evolution in general. And there has been some fascinating stuff going on in the last 20 years since I was paying attention to this particular subject. And one has to do with the whatever happened to dinosaurs. Yes, this is going to make sense in a moment. Around 66 million years ago, there was a catastrophic event, which was very likely a very large asteroid that struck the Earth somewhere off the Yucatan Peninsula in Mexico. And in the millions of years that followed, the climate changed so drastically that about 75% of the extant species on Earth died, including almost all of the dinosaurs. And when I say that almost all of the dinosaurs died out, 25 years ago, I would have said that all of the dinosaurs died out. But in fact, the theropod dinosaurs, that is those that class that includes Tyrannosaurus rex, now famous and known to most school children, Tyrannosaurus rex is a theropod dinosaur. It turns out that the theropod dinosaurs, in fact, did not go extinct. Furthermore, there are between 10 and 12,000 species of theropod dinosaurs extant today, 8 December 2020, on planet Earth. Except you don't know them as theropod dinosaurs. You know them as birds. There has been increasing evidence to suggest that birds are direct descendants of theropod dinosaurs, including features, and this is proven by bone structure, structure of the hands, structure of the breastbone, structure of the pelvis, and most interestingly, over the last 20 years, the evolution of feathers. Charles Darwin was challenged by an interlocutor whose name escapes me, to explain what of what use is half a wing. So in other words, one of Darwin's claims that the origin of species by incremental adaptation occurred over time, that there were intermediate forms in between, say, a limb and a wing. And the challenge to him was, well, what good is a wing that you can't fly with? And why would an animal develop one? And there is intriguing evidence that, first of all, hemi wings or sort of wings, in fact, did develop, did evolve. What they were for exactly, we can only infer by current flightless birds who use their wings for various purposes, such as, or their feathers, for such as keeping warm, protecting eggs, and courtship rituals. And so at least it's plausible, even though it isn't provable. So and obviously, you know, anything that can be inferred from the fossil record really can only be that, an inference, because the animals are not here to tell us show us what they can do and why they do it. Turns out that what you can show is that the dinosaurs, in fact, are quite colorful, and new fossil evidence from China in which melanosomes themselves, color-producing cells, can be produced from fossils, or recovered from fossils, rather, and demonstrating that the theropod dinosaurs, such as Tyrannosaurus rex, were not only colorful, not the sort of drab brown and gray that we're familiar with, but they were, in fact, quite colorful. And that's sort of interesting. And then finally, one other thing that I'll say about what we can learn about dinosaurs from bird biology is that many of them sat on eggs, and that they delivered their clutches in similar ways to many species of birds today. Fascinating stuff. So I am having a great time watching dinosaurs in my backyard and going out on weekends and watching bigger dinosaurs do their thing. Okay, from the sublime to the ridiculous, I want to talk a little bit right now about a narrative which I've been talking about. I've been alluding to it, skipped and danced around it, but it's a narrative that's developing in the press which disturbs me. You know what? I suppose I've handled it sort of head on, but I want to give a couple examples of it, summarize it right off the bat. The theme is this: everything is terrible in the freelance world, and wouldn't it be great if the government came to our aid? But listen to the arguments that the people are using. First of all, I reject this suggestion, would warn those of you listening to this that if you are looking to the government to help you with your problems right now, you are doomed, because nobody is looking out for you. Nobody is looking out for you. You are looking out for you, and you have it within your power to barrel through. Listen, just because I'm doing okay here in the context of the COVID-19 crisis, it doesn't mean that this is easy. It isn't easy. I'm not sure it should be easy. I think people would like it to be easy. I want to read you first a little bit from two articles. The first one is from a trade magazine called museumsassociation.org. And it turns out that freelancers who are involved in the museum industry are not doing so well. And this is what they found out. Nearly four-fifths of museum and heritage freelancers, that is 78%, say that their income fell between March and October this year, 2020, but less than half have been able to access government income support, according to a survey published this week. Compiled by Museum Freelance, the organization that represents freelancers and consultants working in the museum, not sure which museum they're referring to, the museum, gallery, archive, and heritage sectors, there it is, the survey lays bare the, quote, devastating impact, close quote, of the COVID pandemic on freelancers. It shows that just 47% of the 305 respondents have been eligible for grants from the government's Self-Employment Income Support Scheme, SEISS, during the crisis, and 76% have had to find alternative sources of income, such as savings, borrowing, or receiving a grant. Excuse me. First of all, I don't know what country they're talking about here. This very well could be the UK. It could be some other English-speaking country. Suffice to say, I don't believe this is the U.S. In fact, it is from the U.K. The Museums Association is based in London. So we segue right from museum freelancers are having trouble to they're not getting government aid. And isn't that a problem? Shouldn't the government step in? This is a slightly different version of the narrative that I have been bringing to you in recent weeks. If museums-based or heritage-based freelancers are having trouble, it is because these institutions are closed. And they're being closed, they are being forced to close by states, by governments, because states and governments don't trust individuals enough to police themselves in public places. Oh, sure, you can go down to the Home Depot. Home Depot is basically a chain of hardware stores where, folks, when I've been down there on weekends, it has been cheek to cheek and belly to belly full of people. But you can't go to a museum because the museums are all closed. Can't go to the JFK Museum in Hyannis. You can't go to the Wyda Pirate Museum. It's closed. So obviously people who do freelance work on behalf of these places are hurting. And it is really not their fault. It is the state's fault. And the museums can't open. And that's a shame because museums, particularly natural history museums, in my humble opinion, are terrific institutions and they deserve to... It would be a shame if they went away. The artifacts will not go away, but who knows what's going to happen to the museums. But states made these problems, and the way that states can solve these problems is not by redistributing wealth to freelancers who otherwise would have made an honest living in the service of museums and heritage industries, but rather by allowing museums to exert their own discretion and open if they choose to. This next bit is also from the UK because it is from The Guardian, but interestingly, it is a story about the United States. And the headline reads, and it's even got square quotes. Now, it's from the UK, so those square quotes are one tick, not two ticks, but nevertheless, you know, it starts with scare quotes. Just in case you weren't sure that you're supposed to be scared by what you're reading, the headline goes like this, quote, "Right now I'm in panic mode," close quote. U.S. freelancers plead with Congress to pass COVID relief. Millions of self-employed workers are set to lose their benefits after Christmas, and lawmakers have yet to find a solution. I am not going to read this. Folks, this is about freelancers who, in the States, if they in fact exist, whose efforts... whose anger, whose energy is being misdirected. It's being misdirected at external sources. It's being misdirected at government. Government owes me something. There is an interview with a fiber artist who weaves works out of wool and saw her income disappear when farmers markets that she used to sell her stuff at got closed because of the lockdown. And she's ticked off and wants government relief. Now, last time I looked, there was this thing called the internet, and it better be there because I'm going to upload this podcast as soon as I'm done recording it. Now, if she doesn't want to go through all the work to sell her stuff at out of her home or at farmers markets because they're closed, there is this thing called Etsy, E-T-S-Y, which is ideal for fiber artists, and you can sell your stuff there. There are a lot of other creative ways. If, you know, stuff happens, asteroids hit the planet, darn it, and, you know, you either evolve, as we have evolved, or you go extinct. Really, I should have told a dinosaur joke rather than a, what do you call it, what do you call a brontosaurus with, what do you do with a brontosaurus with three balls? You know, walk them and pitch to the theropod. You know, the theropod found a way to survive really, really unfavorable conditions. Now we don't need to find a niche in which to evolve into. All we need to do is take advantage of this enormously favorable thing called the internet and sell our stuff online. Now, if you don't know how to do what it is you do online, I can help you. In the show notes, I'm going to put a link to Skillshare, where I teach courses specifically directed towards freelancers, particularly in the medicine and science editing and writing space. But at Skillshare, you can take literally thousands of courses where you can increase your fund of human capital and learn how to do something that you don't need a museum to work at, for example, because, you know, or you, perhaps I haven't been creative enough in thinking about ways that museum-based freelancers can make money in the absence of the actual three-dimensional museum. But at Skillshare, you can learn how to do stuff and get paid doing it. And what a time to be alive. And if you don't take advantage of this, that's on you, man. That is not the responsibility of the government. And I said it earlier in the program, and I'm going to say it again. No one is looking out for you. I'll say something else. The government is not your friend. They're not your friend. They are not your friend. All right? No one looks out for your best interest better than you do. And I hope that you will do this. I hope that you will go to Skillshare and use if you use the link with my name, not only am I given a very paltry sum for inviting you to join Skillshare, but you get to partake of all of their information, all of their courses, for free for 2 months. For free for 2 months. And I hope that you will do that. So, like I said, I've got a lot of work today, so I'm not going to try to strep this out for 8.5 other minutes. What I hope that you will do, folks, is that you will take this message to heart. An asteroid, so to speak, has hit the world. Evolve. Don't let yourself go extinct. There's no reason for that to happen. And if you do choose to evolve, then surely you will be here next Tuesday, as I will. Until then, I hope that you will be good to yourselves and each other.